Good evening. We have to continue our series, the Tariag Mitzvot, the 613 Mitzvot. Last week we arrived to Mitzvah number 80, and today we are with Mitzvah number 81. It's an obligation of the judges to judge fairly and never to favor the righteous people from the wicked people. Which means if a tzaddik and a wicked person comes to court, the judge has to hear both of them 100% and then make his decision. But he won't go for the religious one against the sinner, because maybe once in a while the sinner is right. And if he does, it's a sin from the Torah for the judges. Mitzvah number 82, that the judges, the dayanim, the Jewish judges, when they sit in court, they have to judge based on 100% knowledge, not assumption, not certainty, not chazakah, not something that 99% out of 100 this will be the case, doesn't mean in that particular case it was the same. So anything that you can think for sure that's what happened, if you don't know, if there is any doubt, the judge cannot convict a person in the sin or in the crime. And this is different than the United States court, because in America, it's beyond any reasonable doubt. But in a Jewish court, it's beyond any doubt. Remember the difference. In America, if the police can prove that you went to the hotel in the time of the murder and you were in a room for 2 minutes and nobody else went in and you came out and 2 minutes later the person was dead and they found that somebody choked him, so they will convict you. Even though nobody ever saw in their own eyes that you're the one who choked him. Yeah, most likely it was you. Who else went into the room? But how do you know? Maybe somebody dug through the hole and he came underneath and choked him and went and you never found. It could be one out of a million, but you don't know 100%. So the Torah say you don't judge based on chazakot, omed adat, based on assumption. Or maybe because this person already was convicted 10 times in this crime, and he was in the time of the robbery, for sure it was him. However, it gives you the right to go after him first, to investigate him. He cannot come and say to you, what about giving me the benefits of the doubt? Isn't it kaf zchut? So you can tell him, no, because you're already convicted in the past in this kind of crimes. We must start with you, because you are number one in our suspicion. We suspect you the most. But we cannot convict you in a court unless if we know for sure. Mitzvah number 83, judges are warned not to take bribe, not to take any shochad. Now, shochad, usually it's money. Bribe, it's money. The Torah says, v'shochad lo tikach. And then in another place, he says, lo tikach shochad. You know, the Torah says, why it's repeat twice? Not to send free the guilty person, that's for one reason, not to favor the guilty person, because he paid you money, or his father, or whatever, and not to favor the one who is right. Well, why do you need bribe? If I'm right, if I'm right in my case against somebody else, why do I have to bribe the judge? Why is it? Maybe the judge will make a mistake. I don't want to take the risk. It's too much to lose. So I say, well, what do I know? Maybe this judge is a fool. And instead of him making a mistake that will cost you $1 million, let me send him a box of cigars just to make sure he's going to do the right thing. And the judge, when he sees that I'm right, he says, well, what's the problem taking these cigars? Anyway, I'm looking. I already see. I know he's right. Anyway, I would favor him. He's the one who deserves to get the money. It's still a sin from the Torah. It's still a sin from the Torah. Worse, even when the court case was over and the person who won the case 100% honestly, without cheating, without bribe, without anything, and he knows that this judge has a yeshiva and he wants to send him donation, and he sends a donation a month after the trial, the judge is not allowed to receive this. If he receives it, it's also a sin from the Torah. It's called later bribe. Now, a bribe before the decision, everybody understands it, and it's not allowed, even in a secular court. If the judge will get caught taking bribes, it's the end of his career, most likely. But why not to receive a gift a month later for doing the right thing? Somebody wants to send him a letter of recommendation. Dear judge, you know, I like you very much. You did the right thing. You judge fairly. You're clever. And I know you have an institution. You're taking care of orphan kids. Here is a $10,000 check. My appreciation for your charity movement, whatever, organization. What's the problem? The answer is, the Torah says it's not allowed for one very simple reason. If you allow it, automatically all the judges will always favor the powerful and the wealthy people. Why? From the poor, no donation will come. Even though today it's completely the opposite, can tell you from experience, that the very, very wealthy, unfortunately, they're busy with other things. And the ordinary people, they are the one who care to donate. But the mind of a judge is, if somebody that worth $2 billion standing here, and he's suing one of his tenants that hardly makes a living, if I'll go towards the tenant won't send any donation for my yeshiva. But if I'll take the rich guy, there is a chance that he's going to send a nice donation. Not guarantee. But I always take the rich people's side, and that's increasing my possibility of receiving all kinds of nice donations. That's why the Torah says even gifts after, even you didn't know at the time that you judge. But if you receive a month or a year later a gift from that judge, that means from now on the next cases, you won't be objective. You will take always the sides. Also, a bribe is not only money. A bribe is you found a job to his cousin. You smile to him in the elevator. Do you know that according to the Torah, if you go to the Beit Din and you go out in the elevator and you didn't know he's your judge, saw a rabbi in the elevator. How are you, rabbi? Yeah, what do you think about what happened this week? Wow, amazing, amazing. Yeah, wow, Hashem will help. They had a conversation with him. Now he has to judge you. 10 minutes later, he found out that he's your judge. Cannot judge you fairly anymore. Cannot judge you fairly. And, you know, I have many, many examples to give from the Gemara. Even a smile can be a bribe. So therefore, we got to be very careful when it comes to a bribe. Now, one more thing I want to say here. If a person comes to you and say, you know, this guy Moshe is a very, very big Talmid Chacham. Who tells you this? A person that doesn't know how to read Hebrew. He himself a complete ignorant. He comes to you and say to you, you know, this guy, you know what? How much Torah he knows? According to his understanding, this guy is Rabbi Ovadia Yosef. Why? He doesn't know two words. So whenever he gave a 5-minute speech, wow, this guy is amazing. So if you have to marry your daughter to this guy based on the testimony of this fool, you're not going to do it. Why? You don't rely on him. What does he know to tell the difference between a real Chacham and a fake Chacham? He doesn't know. Okay. If a person that knows Torah, like a Rav of a Shul, he has a shul, he gives speeches, everybody knows, he knows Torah. He comes and tells you, Moshe is a chacham, he knows Torah, he loves Torah, he's a good guy. Oh, now you're already taking it seriously. If Rabbi Ovadia Yosef or Rav Eliashiv come to you and say, this one is a very big chacham, do you have a doubt by now? Right, do you tell your daughter, hurry up, hurry up, we get lucky, maybe this guy will take you, Baruch Hashem. You don't even go and find out. If Rav Eliashiv tell you, this guy is a very big tzaddik and chacham, believe me, you don't call the references. You don't. You trust him 100%. If the Rambam come to you in a dream, he say, I'm Moshe ben Maimon, and I tell you, this guy, for your daughter, you'll be a luckiest guy. He's a big chacham, and he's very important in Shamayim. Even though Chalomot Shav Yedaberu, it could be a demon, there are demons who call Yehudim, Jews. Why? Because they come in the image of a big chachamim. The demon can come to you in a dream and you think it's the Baba Sali. You think it's Rav Moshe Feinstein. They make themselves look like famous people. But it's very difficult to know if it was really the chacham or it came from the Sitra Achra. That's why you cannot rely on dreams in anything. Not to tell you to do good thing or not to tell you to do bad thing. But that's besides the point. But hypothetically speaking, the Rambam came and he said to you, this guy is the best. Now you don't ever worry. If HaKadosh Baruch Hu comes to you and say to you, this guy is a Chacham, do you have even a thought that maybe he's not? Now you know, not only is a Chacham, he's Chacham according to all standards. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu put his stamp on him. Maybe Rav Ovadia thinks he's Chacham, but the Rambam doesn't. Maybe the Rambam thinks he's Chacham, but Moshe Rabbeinu disagrees so much. Still, but Hashem says a Chacham, I don't care what the rest says. For sure, he's a big Chacham. So far, everything clear? When HaKadosh Baruch Hu wrote this mitzvah in the Torah, do not receive bribe. This is Hashem say, ki ha-shochad ya'aver enei chachamim v'yisalef divrei tzadikim. The bribe will make the eyes of the chachamim, of the knowledgeable scholars, will make them blind and will twist the words from the truth. And which kind of chachamim HaKadosh Baruch Hu talks? Fake like us? No. Real one. Chachamim like means Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Moshe Rabbeinu. Someone that HaKadosh Baruch Hu say, yeah, big chacham. Not someone who the newspaper made him chacham like today. The newspaper decide who's chacham, who's not. A real chacham will be blinded by bribe. I think that makes everything clear here, which means none of us is safe. You'll be a judge, you're sitting in a board, you're making decisions, you're sitting in an office, you give permits. People want to bribe you. Very difficult to stay honest and never to be blinded by the bribe. One last thing about bribe. The Torah didn't say the bribe will make the righteous people lie, or the chachamim will lie because they receive bribe. That's what it should have said. I know this guy is a crook, and I know this guy is right. But I'm going and saying to the righteous person, the crook is right, without saying the crook. This gentleman is right, please pay him $10,000, end of case. Now, I know I'm lying. Why? He gave me money before the trial. That's why I ruled for his favor. But that's not what the Torah says. That's not what's happening. If that would be the case, the Chachamim wouldn't take the money. If they knew that they're doing something wrong, even for a lot of money, most of them wouldn't agree. Because we have many, many cases of righteous people that you offer them a lot of money to eat something not kosher, they'll never do it. What's the difference? Anyway, either one is a sin from the Torah, no? If I make a sin from the... If you come to me and say, listen, one time light the electric on Shabbat, I'll give you $10,000 gift. One time. I just want to prove to my son that money buys everything. Come on, Rabbi. No, here, nobody see. Come to the bathroom. Here, 10,000. Here, it's yours. Just turn it on, take the money. Okay, no, give the money. Right? I don't know anyone would do it. Even if he needs the money for rent tomorrow. But when to rule for the crooked people, then, according to the Torah, he will do it. But that's not what Hashem meant. If they knew that they're doing the wrong thing, they would not accept the bribe. That's not what Hashem was saying. This is a very, very common mistake that everybody misunderstands this Torah. Almost nobody understands it. The Torah didn't say the Chacham will take the money and know that he's lying. The Torah say it would make him blind. A blind person wants to see, but he cannot see. He would see the opposite and would be sure that he favors the righteous person and not the wicked one. If you connect him to a lie detector after the trial ends, he will pass the test with no problem. He would put his life on the line and swear with the Torah in his hand that he gave the money to the person who deserved it. This is the power of the bribe. It takes the person and mamash take control of his brain on his eyes to see the opposite of the truth. Remember, there's a big difference. To know that I'm lying and cooperating with a crooked person, receiving money and saying, no, he's right. That's not what Hashem was worried about. These people who sit in a court, in a holy court, they're going to be like this, low life? No. Why I'm afraid? Because once they receive the money or the favor, that from that moment on they cannot see anything negative about him. And this is why we don't see anything negative about ourselves, because we love ourselves so much, we're in love with ourselves. That's why we don't see our sins. If somebody sits in your bed, you live in a dorm with someone. When you sit on his bed, what did I do? Well, when he sits on the bed, you're ready to kill him. No? If you sit on your roommate's bed, and your roommate gets upset, right? You ask him, what did I do that you hate me so much? I sat on your blanket. What happened? Okay, I'm sorry. But he's getting angry. Tomorrow he does the same thing to somebody else and he doesn't think he did anything wrong. Just yesterday he gave the whole speech about you should not speak Lashon Hara. 2 minutes later he speaks Lashon Hara. When someone spoke about you, you see it. But when you speak, you don't even see that it's something. You don't see. It's not that you know I'm doing something wrong and I pretend that is nothing. No, I don't feel that I did anything wrong. This is the power of the bride. Remember that it makes you see the opposite. Mitzvah number 84, mitzvah shmitat karkaot. Generally speaking, every 7 years there is a Shabbat of the land. We have 6 days in a week and in the 7 days we have to rest. Same thing, the farmers, and in the old days almost everyone was a farmer. The farmers work on their land for 6 years and comes the 7 years 1 month before. 1 month before, the beginning of Rosh Chodesh Elul, they stop working on the land. They leave everything. They don't cut the fruits anymore. They don't cut branches. They don't give water. They don't plow the ground. They don't clean the weeds. None of these things. For how long? For 1 year. So every 7 years, the seventh year, the land is hefker. Every poor person wants to come, things and eat, free. Cannot put fence, you cannot tell them don't come. It's really not mine anymore. Once the Torah says Shnat Shemitah, that's it, you're not allowed to sell it, and many, many examples like this. And Hashem promised that on the sixth year, you're going to have enough fruit or wheat or whatever you have, enough for the sixth and the seventh, and to start also in the eighth to reprocess your land. It will be enough on the sixth year also for the seventh, but you have to have strong emunah, strong faith in Hashem, not to worry, not to go to work for 1 year, but don't worry. I will already give you enough on the sixth year to survive 1 year without working. We have an example from the generation of the Midbar, the desert. On Friday, man was falling double. Man, right? On Friday, Hashem sent twice, for Friday and for Shabbat. Same concept over here when it comes to the land. Rav Mordechai Sharabi was a very big Kabbalist, Yemenite in Israel, 30 years ago. His memory was once in a blue moon, you find people with such sharp memory. When he was teaching Gemara, he didn't hold a Gemara. Everyone had a Gemara in their hand, and he was teaching without Gemara. Everything, he knew everything, the Rashi, the Tosfot, came to the Shi'ur ready without Gemara. He was teaching them, mamash, reading, knowing where they talk about, without having the Gemara. This is how his memory was strong. He was also, as I said, very humble, very holy person. Very hard to find people like this in the world, if ever. And he used to take his students on the sixth year to his garden. He had a little garden in his house, tomatoes, cucumbers, whatever. And what was he doing? He said to them, I want you to come and visit in my house to see, what's to see? That on the sixth year, it gives double of the amount of every year. Double cucumbers, double tomatoes, whatever he was growing there. He wanted to show them how, and still in this day it applies. By the way, you should know there are many farmers in Israel who keeps it in Israel. They do it. For 1 year, they don't touch the land, nothing.
So what do we do?
And they survive. It's a fact, they survive. Let's move on. Mitzvah number 85. What's the mitzvah number 85? to strike from any melacha on Shabbat. A person is not allowed to do one of the 39 things that the Torah restricted. The Torah says you should not sow, you should not write, you should not cook, you should not plow the ground, you should not put seeds in the ground, you cannot paint. There's all kinds of things that the Torah says you're not allowed to do. You're not allowed to separate the bad out of the good. Many, many things, 39 altogether. So if a person is working, doing melacha, melacha doesn't mean work. I say that in my lecture on Shabbat. A person can sweat the entire Shabbat and then he needs to sleep for 2 days to rest from the physical efforts he did on Shabbat. But he did not violate Shabbat. On the other hand, a person can move his finger like this and he just made the worst sin possible in life. Violated Shabbat, the worst. And God forbid, lost his share to the world to come. He lost his eternity by going like this, finished. Why? The Torah didn't say not to work hard on Shabbat. Nothing to do with physical work, like many people think. The Torah say, Melechet machshevet asra Torah. Creative work, the Torah is forbidden. What does it mean, creative work? First, it has to be built in your brain. What do I want to do? I want to have light here. That's first step. First, I decide what I want. And then when I want to have light, I'm thinking, how do I get light? I go over there and I turn the switch, or I connect to wires, or I turn the match. This is how it goes. For instance, if I was tired and I leaned on the wall without seeing the switch, and I turned the electric on, it's not even a sin. You don't even need to bring a sacrifice to the Beit HaMikdash if it happens to you. Why? It never crossed your mind. When you did the transaction, it never started in a head. It's not a sin. It's not a violation. You didn't think, I want light here and therefore I'm going to do something. That's not how it did. You just leaned on the wall without knowing there's a switch there and all of a sudden you have light. This light you can even enjoy from on Shabbat because it wasn't a violation. But if I knew that I want light, but I forgot it's Shabbat. For a minute, I forgot it's Shabbat. I was so upset. I was thinking about something. I don't know. I come out of my bedroom, and I turn the light on or something, or off. On is worse than off. But, oh, I remember Shabbat. I didn't mean to violate Shabbat. I'm a religious person. Now I have to bring a sacrifice to Beit HaMikdash and lose my business. I have $1 million business, it's gone. Why? We are talking 2,000 years ago. There's no car, no trains, no nothing. A person who violates Shabbat by mistake, by forgetting it's Shabbat, or by forgetting that this is not allowed on Shabbat, or by not knowing because he didn't learn. Either one of the three, it's called not intentional. Either I forgot it's Shabbat, or I didn't know this transaction is not allowed on Shabbat, I didn't know, or I forgot that it's not allowed. Doesn't matter. I did not mean to do a sin. What do I have to do? I have to take a goat to Beit HaMikdash, a sheep, sacrifice it, and remember, today, to go from anywhere in Israel to Jerusalem is maximum 2 hours driving. But in the old days, you had to go with a little carriage all the way up between the forest, the wheels are breaking until you get to Jerusalem, sometimes 2 weeks to get there. And then 2 weeks to come back home. How long? 1 month. Do you know a business that the owner of the business is 1 month not in a business and when he comes back, the business is still there? The employees sucked all your blood. When you come, you see nothing left there. They know that my owner now went to Jerusalem for a month. For what? If take any business that the boss come to his workers and say, hey, I'm going to Israel for a month. And see if when they come back, the business is still there. The business will be destroyed. What happened if the next Shabbat he made it again or a month later? So sometimes it can be 2-3 months in Jerusalem. Maybe he moved to live there. You know, he makes a lot of sins in Shabbat. He rents a place across the street from the Kotel. You know why? All this traveling. So this is for not intentional sin. If he did it intentionally, it's finished. Stoning by the Jewish court. If he got the warning, continue to do it, finished. Now we are talking here A person can walk in his house. Let's say he have 200 guests came to him for a bar mitzvah in his house for his son. And he doesn't have enough tables. He didn't expect so many people. So in the first floor, he had 5 tables, but he needs much more. So what does he do? He say to his friends, we have no choice. Let's serve a quick meal right here. Then we clear the table. We take the table to the second floor quickly. We set it up over there. Then we clean here. We make a meal over there. Then we take it down. All Shabbat. Seudah Rishona go up and down, 5 tables on his head, he's sweating, his back is broken, takes it back, cleans it, set the table, bring the food, clean, bring the drinks, take it out, takes the garbage to the deck. All Shabbat like a slave. Not one Chilul Shabbat. Tzaddik. No problem. Cigarette, finished. So don't ever think that Shabbat is because of hard work. Even a person who sleeps all day and snores because he has millions of dollars and is now worried about Parnassa, Shabbat is not allowed to violate. It wasn't a physical rest like something. It's all creative in the mind. Hashem did not create anything. There was no system of creation on the 7th day. I want you, the Jew, to be little Hashem, to be like me. 6th day I created with my creative mind. 7th day I went to rest. My mind, everything was all rested. You're going to be the same thing. 7th day you don't create. You don't start new things. You don't create energy. You don't connect things in the wrong way, etc., etc. This is mitzvah number 85. Of course, we can talk about it 7 years straight. Just for you to know that a person that wants to know 100% how to keep Shabbat, if he's a very smart person, need to learn approximately 7 years from morning to night straight to be able to know how to keep Shabbat. So in case you have a thought, we're keeping Shabbat with tzaddikim, think again. There's a lot more to know, there's a lot more to learn. I sometimes meet people that are 20 years religious Shomer Shabbat, or I see them coming to me for Shabbat and I see what they do and they have no idea how to keep Shabbat. You understand? So maybe it's time to learn. Because you want to finally do the right thing, and then in the end Hashem say, well, you know, the way to Gehenom is full of good intentions. You know how the Goyim say? The way to Gehenom, to hell, it's full of good intentions. I know he had good intentions, but what can I do? When does good intention does take into consideration? I'll give you an example. If you saw a fire by your friend's house and you ran to help, emergency, screaming, fire, help me, fire. So you went, you bring from the lake water, you run into his house, you spill. You run again, you bring water. Remember, there was no faucets. So you run, running, bringing water. All the neighbors, everyone bring water, and they try to put the fire off. And while you're doing it, you broke a vase from China that worth $50,000 with your leg by mistake because of the panicking. And now he sued you. He sued you in court. So listen, I know you came to help me. You helped me with $50. You made me $50,000 damage. Don't you know the sentence, the way to Gehenom is full of good intentions? You gotta pay me. What can I do? I know it's bad, but yeah, I know it was an accident. I'm not saying you're a bad person, but who's gonna pay me? He's not guilty. The judges won't even take this claim. Why? Hashem didn't want people to be afraid to help. If you will find him guilty, that was the end of all the chesed and of the brotherhood. Nobody, people will see you dead on the street, nobody come to help you. Well, I'm crazy, he's gonna sue me for his spine. You move me, you this, let him die. I also wanna live. Let his house burn. Why should I take a risk? I'm work, I'm gonna sweat, I don't get paid for it. In the end, he's gonna tell me, pay me for the vase or for the Persian rug. Nobody does anything, it will be the end of the world. And Hashem is very interested that there will be a world of kindness. That's why he dismissed all cases against people who come to volunteer and help. But if you want to keep Shabbat and you never learn how and you're violating Shabbat, you're 100% guilty, in case you didn't know. So it's better, it's good to learn. First step to buy a book, Shmirat Shabbat Lematchilim, Shabbat Observant to Beginners. You learn all the terms, intentional sin, not intentional, when you are guilty, when you are not guilty, All these things, the list of the 39 restrictions, half of them doesn't apply. We have a major discount today because we are not farmers. We don't plow the ground, we don't put seeds on Shabbat. There's many things we don't do. So right away, some of the like kneading and things like this, we don't have in our days, and at least not in civilized society. So the 20 that we have to do, you have to learn how to do it, not to do, what to do, how to do, how many times, etc., etc. Mitzvah number 86, not to swear in Avodah Zarah. A Jew is arguing with the Indian guy. The Indian guy every morning, standing with his cup, by his cow to drink. He wants to make himself cornflakes, so he has a bowl. He puts lots of cornflakes inside. But they don't put the milk of the cow, in case you thought that he's standing by the milk. He stands by the other hole when the urine comes out. Because in India, in case you don't believe me, a fight who's going to drink the bathroom of the cow. Because the cow is Mother Nature, it's holy. You know? Why the cow is holy, according to Hinduism? Because the cow gave birth in 9 months. Very interesting. Somebody thought there's something mutual between the cow to my mother. They're both very heavy, but that's not what I meant. They both give birth after nine months. So it has to be that the cow is divine. Has to be. Just like my mother is divine. So the cow became our God. So stupid, but that's what it is. So now you fight with your Maharaji there that likes the cow very much when it walks in Bombay over there. And you say to him, I swear in your cow that I didn't steal money from you. Now, you don't believe in his cow. You know it's stupid, but you want him to be convinced. See that cow that you bow down to every day? I swear in this cow, that in your God, that I didn't steal money. And he said, oh, okay. I'm sorry, I suspect you. How can you swear in the life of my cow, you know? So that's a sin from the Torah. Why? Oh, I swear in your J.C. Penney statue. You know, that you like this every day, or whatever, all kinds of idols that they have, all kinds of Avodah Zarah, I swear in your God, it's a big sin for us. What's the problem? Hashem knows I don't like this idol. Hashem knows I make fun of these idols. Hashem knows I'm not a fool to believe that this piece of metal will bring me my salvation. He knows it. He knows I'm actually laughing in my heart when this guy accepts my testimony. So what's the problem? What sin I made? The sin is that I make his statue have a special value. Oh, the Jew is swearing in my God, or in my idol, or in my book. Or he say to hold the New Testament and swear. All these idol-worshipping things, it's a sin from the Torah. What happened the other way around? You come to your worker, and you tell to him, listen, I'm missing $100 from the register. 5 minutes ago it was $700, now it's $600. Did you steal money? No, God forbid, we're religious, we don't steal. So he said, I want you to come to your Buddha, the one that you pray in the back every day in your car, bring it over here, and I want you to swear to me in the life of your Buddha that you did not steal. Now it's the other way around. Anyway, he does it all the time. That's his God, not mine. Well, I'm making him swear in his own idol. I say to him, come, bring your whatever, and swear to me that you did not steal. Technically, it should have worked. Because I always said, what's better? Now you have an opportunity to go into partnership with a not religious Jew. Or with the Hindu that worship the cow, or with some kind of Chinese that worship Buddha, or whatever the case may be. Now, who's better partner? The one who bow down to Buddha every day, or to the sun, or to the moon, or whatever. Or an Israeli guy that doesn't believe in Hashem, Torah, religion, and does whatever he feels like. Who is more dangerous as a partner? The answer is, of course, the Jew that doesn't believe in anything is much more of a threat. Why? When you're not in a business, as soon as you walk through the door, his mind begins, how do I cheat my partner? Why? Because he has nobody to fear from. He doesn't believe someone watch him. But this, Mustafa, Chris, Raja, Bruce Lee, whatever their name is, you know, he's thinking someone is watching me. The God of this, the God of that, that God, whatever. Everyone has his own idol, whatever. So he has a fear from a phony God, but in his mind is a real God. Why is he dedicating his life for this? Because he believes in it. So when I'm not in a business, this Hindu or Muslim or Christian or whatever it may be, is having somebody to be afraid of. That's a guard. That's like special security for me. Why? I don't have to worry so much because he has ira. He has ira, not irat shamayim. Irat the cow, ira of this, ira of this, but he has ira from someone. But over here, I may come and say to him, listen, you know what? I'm going to put your Buddha on a cash register to look at you that you don't steal. Not allowed. Why? What's the problem? Anyway, he does it. When he fights with his own Indian friend, don't they swear in the name of this God that they didn't steal or whatever? I swear to you, I didn't cheat, the wife said to the husband. Swear in Buddha. So they bring Buddha, they all go like this. And they pray. I mean, they swear. So why can't I benefit from their stupidity? Why can't I? So before we understood why. Why? Because the Jew make it look like real. Here is the same thing. When you make him bring it and say, I want you to swear in your God, that means you're making his God legit. And Hashem cannot stand any idols worshiping. This was between Jews and Goyim. Now, how can it be the same thing between Jew to a Jew? A Jew that is idol is his rabbi. There are thousands of Jews or tens of thousands of Jews that are exactly like this. They idol worshiping. Even though they keep Shabbat, they eat kosher, and they maybe not steal, and they go to shul to pray, and they do almost everything that a religious person does. Almost everything. And they have one mistake. The rabbi that died is the real God. They also believe in Hashem. Also. But if you ask them who is the priority God, is that rabbi with his grave. They go there every day. Every word comes out of their mouth. They only talk about him. They don't learn in any other book. Only in his books. Moshe Rabbeinu, Rambam, this, Gemara. It's not for me. Yeah, it's interesting to look at it once in a while. But what that Rebbe said, that's my whole life. This is just the same. They also have an idol. Or Jews that think that in order for me to be righteous in the eyes of Hashem, I can only connect to Hashem through that Rebbe, through that rabbi who died, or through that rabbi who is still alive. Doesn't matter, alive or died. Either way, I can only connect to Hashem through that rabbi. The Ramban in Shara Gmul writes that people like this go to hell and never ever come out of there for eternity. What about all the mitzvot they kept? Won't help them at all, because when it comes to idol worshiping, there is no tolerance whatsoever. Now you do the math. How many of our brothers with beards and hats out there are falling into this category? You do the math. That's what's happening today. And that's why, not that we are perfect. We have, believe me, we have a lot of problems to worry about ourselves. All of us, everyone. But this is an example of Jews who wants to be righteous, who works very hard to keep the mitzvot of the Torah, and in the end they come to Shamayim, they'll be very surprised. Why? Because Hashem said to him, why all your life was this was your God? Why everything you spoke only about him? Why everywhere you go you put his pictures? Why everything you made your children pray to him to find them a soulmate? Why it's all about him? Why when he came into the shul, all of you were quiet, but when he left, you started to talk in the middle of the prayer. Why, I wasn't there? With me over there, you're talking. But when he's there, you're not talking, huh? You understand what's going on here? That's very dangerous. So idol worshiping is very, very problematic. Even something that was given to an idol as a gift. It wasn't an idol, such as a hair of a woman in India. She cannot offer any money. She shaved her hair and gave it to the idol. And then they sold it to some wig dealer in Italy. And he made from it custom-made wig, and it ended up in Bnei Brak. Something like this can create big problems to the woman who puts it on her head. Why is it? Because this was a gift to an idol. Tikovet avodah zarah. A tree. Some of the goyim worship trees. Anything relates to that tree. Any flowers, the hanging, all kinds of nice kishutim, like the Christmas tree, and all these things that they put. Everything that connects to their idol, and you want to enjoy from it for another work, is not permitted. When you come to a place that there was an idol standing over there, not only you have to smash it to pieces and burn it and not leave a memory of it, you have to dig the ground under it enough deep not to leave any smell of this idol that was there. This is what the Torah says. First thing the Jews had to do when they went to Israel, get rid of all the idols of the seven nations. Just plenty of idols. A big war. It's a big war over there to fight against all this nonsense. This was the beginning of entering Eretz Israel, to clean it from all the filth. Now, mitzvah number 87, not to persuade any Jew to follow Avodah Zarah, idol worshipping. Come with us to the grave of that tzaddik. Pray to him, maybe he will send you parnasa. That's an idol worshipping. Come to us to this country over there in a special day. Pray by his grave. Thanks to him, you're going to have this and this and that. If he only goes to a grave of any righteous person and asks him, thanks to your righteousness, maybe Hashem will have mercy on me. That's a different story. But it's a very thin line. Two people stand by the grave. One is doing a mitzvah. One is doing a very big sin. Why? The one who's doing a mitzvah is only thinking, maybe because God loved this righteous person and I came to pay him respect in his grave, he will accept my prayer thanks to his righteousness. It's like hiring a good lawyer that the judge likes. I don't mean that my life is in the hand of this lawyer. It's only in the hand of Hashem. But I'm trying to do whatever I can that the judge would like this lawyer. He would listen to what I have to say. And the other one who stands right there, he prays to this person who died there, you give me a children. I don't have kids. Make sure you give me a son. I came to you. I'm begging you. Please give me a son. Please cure me. Please do this for me. Both of them almost the same. One or two words different in a prayer. One is making a good mitzvah. Not necessary. Because if you sit in yeshiva and learn Torah, it's much better than waste time on this. But finally, it's a mitzvah after all. And the other one is making the worst sin in the Torah. What are the worst sins in the Torah? It always goes together. Whenever all the books of law speaking about sinners, it goes together in the same category. Mechalel Shabbat ve'oved avodat kochavim u'mazalot. Translation, Mechalel Shabbat, violating Shabbat, and an idol worshipping has the same judgment. Say everything the same. Both of them cannot be one of the ten in a minyan. Both of them cannot pray in a shul. Both of them, if they say Kaddish, you're not allowed to answer Amen. Many other restrictions apply to both of them equally. Because they exclude themselves out of the Jewish nation until they make 100% tshuva. They stop with the nonsense. They regret. They're not doing it anymore. They start to keep. No more idols. That's a different story. So right away, they go to a kosher status. Then, so if you convince another person, come, there's a mekubal in Brooklyn. He writes special thing, believe me. You give it to your mother, you see, 2 days she'll be cured. Rabbi, what are you talking about? It's a rabbi, you know what a long beard he had? You should see what he writes, it's thing from the Kabbalah. All these things. How much you pay? $200 for a piece of paper. Come to me, I'll sell you the paper for $2. Why you have to pay $200 for a piece of paper from a copy machine? Huh? Because he has a long beard. The Maharishi in India have a longer beard and wider. So what is it? But the people's stupidity somehow become worse and worse instead of better. No matter how many times you repeat it, no matter times how you warn them, how you try to make them understand that they're doing something against what Hashem wants, not what Hashem wants, They will continue with the same nonsense. And then they convince another Kam to come. Kam, he's going to do this hocus pocus to you. He has these things. I don't know how he does it. All these things, some of it is real Avodah Zarah, some of it is on the border of being Avodah Zarah. Then mitzvah number 88, to celebrate the three festivals, Shloshet HaRegalim, Sukkot, Pesach, and Shavuot, all male, older than 13 years old, going to Yerushalayim for the entire holiday to celebrate with the sacrifices and the holiness of the rabbis in Yerushalayim. That's a mitzvah of Shlosha Regalim. We're going up all the way to Beit HaMikdash. Remember, if you'll be today, it's very easy. Take a train, you're there. You take a car, you're there. In the old days, it was a real operation. So that's a mitzvah. Three times a year, it falls into one mitzvah. Shloshet HaRegalim. Mitzvah number 89, not to slaughter the goat of Passover. When do we do it? A few hours before Leil HaSeder, when it's still light outside. We prepare this sacrifice, and we have to do it with matzah, when the matzot is ready, which means we got rid of all the chametz. After we burn the chametz, after the house is clean, there's no more any chametz around our area, then we begin to prepare this goat. In the Exodus of Egypt, they took it and tied it to the bed for 4 days. 4 days it was tied to a bed, and the goyim were asking the Jews, why each one of you has a goat with a knot, with a leash tied to their bed? Well, what is this? You have a new thing now? No, we're going to slaughter it. Now, this was the god of the Egyptians. Imagine here in America, every Jew can take a big cross and tie it by his house with a leash, and all the Christians will say, hey, what happened? Boropar became full of crosses? What's going on? And they ask you, well, why do you have these crosses here? You don't believe in it. So no, we're making a big fire of it tomorrow. Making thing, what's going to happen? This is what Hashem told the Jews to do. What? To get on their nerve on purpose. And to see that there's nothing they're going to do about it. Because I'm the master of the world. Let them burn their heart, all these idol worshippers. And they'll plan to kill you. And they'll do whatever they can to stop it. And I'm in charge of everything. And they're not going to make a beep. And that's what happened. Today we don't have to do it, but in the time of Beit HaMikdash, they used to prepare it. So now this mitzvah, number 89, you're not allowed to slaughter it in the 14 days of Nisan. Remember, Leil HaSeder, it's the 15th of Nisan, which means the day in Judaism starts in the sunset at night. Once it becomes dark, we're going into the 15th day of Nisan. But before it was dark, it was still the 14th of Nisan. That's when you slaughter this goat, Korban HaPesach. And once we have it, half a day, you know. So, Shelo Nishchat Seah Pesach, we're not allowed to slaughter it, and the 14th day of Nisan, while we still have chametz in our position. Until we got rid of all the chametz, and that's when we begin. Now remember, we don't eat chametz already 4 hours from the day, we don't eat. But really, really, not to enjoy from it in any way, it's 6 days, midday, today it's 10 to 1. Today it would be, tonight it would be Leil HaSeder, and today, up to one, if you had by mistake chametz, no, but after that, that's already a sin from the Torah. It's not Isur Karet or anything like this, but it's also already a sin from the Torah. So, if you still have chametz, let's say by mistake, I don't know, something happened, in the last minute you found it, and you were already ready, getting ready to slaughter this goat, and not allowed to do it while you still have chametz. Why? Because this symbolizes the opposite of anything relates to chametz. It's already the beginning of Pesach. You don't mix between them. It's like wool and linen. You don't mix between them. That's mitzvah number 89. Mitzvah number 90. Once we sacrifice the goat, we're not allowed to leave it all the way overnight to the morning. If you keep it, then they become pasul. Sheneemar, velo yalin chelev chagi ad boker, the internal parts of the animal, and not only this, other korbanot as well, not allow to leave these parts that call chelev inside all the way to the morning. If somebody does it, this is, for instance, one of the mitzvot that doesn't make sense to human logic. Why? What's the problem that it stayed to the morning? Some of these things is very, very deep. We don't really understand what it means. But someone who does it violate, this is a restriction for the Kohanim, because they are the one who takes care of it. Ken noeg bizman habayit, only in a time Beit HaMikdash exists, bizcharim Kohanim, male Kohanim, male Kohen. Mitzvah number 91, mitzvah, we have 5 more minutes, so let's do another one or two mitzvot. Mitzvah number 91, to bring bikurim, basket with the best fruits, to Beit HaMikdash. What is bikurim? Bikurim come from the word bechor. What bechor means? Firstborn. If you have a kid, first one who was born is called bechor. On the tree, the first fruit who comes out in the season, they are called bechorot. So taking from the best fruit, a pri arishon shemitbashel ba'ilan. Now remember, this is also a confusion. We are not talking the one who started to grow first on the tree. Sometimes you have fruit A and fruit B, one next to another. A started to grow first. When you went to that branch, you saw the fruit starting here first. But you came 2 weeks later, now the fruit B that was not even exist, now it's much bigger. So it's already ripe before the first fruit. So which one you have to bring to Hashem? The one who started first, or the one who became ripe and ready to be eaten first? The one, shivshilu, that became ripe, you take the nicest one and you give it as a gift to the Kohanim. You bring it to Beit HaMikdash, you give it to the Kohen. But not every tree, not the orange tree, lemon tree, etc. Only the 7 special fruits that the Torah mentioned, shivat aminim. What are they? Wheat, barley, grapes, gefen, figs, pomegranate, olive, and dates. Those are the special, extra special fruits that the Torah mentioned a few times. They are special tree, special fruits. Sheneemar reshit bikurei atmatcha tavi, and the Torah, the Gemara explained that the Torah meant these 7 special fruits. And they bring it to the Kohanim in Beit HaMikdash. Today, when we don't have Beit HaMikdash, so the students bring to the rabbis some kind of a basket in Chol HaMoed. They come to visit the Rav. It's as a memory to this mitzvah that we have. There's a custom. Some people like to do it. They come to the sukkah of the rabbi in Chol HaMoed, or in Pesach Chol HaMoed. They come to the house. They bring something, whatever. It's not an obligation, but it's a nice custom. 92, mitzvah 92, not to cook together meat and milk. Meat and milk. From the Torah, we are talking meat of an animal, not meat of a chicken. Meat of a chicken from the Torah wasn't a sin. Later, the Chachamim, the righteous sages, that Hashem gave them the authority to make laws and fences around the restrictions in the Torah to protect the Torah. So they saw that the people get confused between meat of a turkey or rooster or whatever to meat that comes from a goat or veal. Sometimes it looks very similar, especially when it's cooked. And there's a risk that a person would see a Jew eating a cheeseburger that's made from chicken, turkey meatballs, put it with melted cheese in a toaster. Really, without the interference of the rabbis, it wasn't a sin from the Torah. But the rabbis saw that Jews would see people eat this kind of food, and they will get confused, because not everyone is a big chacham. Oh, I saw this rabbi with a beard like this, eating this meatball with cheese or drinking milk together. Oh, that means it's permitted. So he take a beef burger and does the same. Since it would lead for sure to Jews making sin, so the rabbis put a ban on it, not allowed. But now we are talking the restriction from the Torah originally is a meat of any animal, beef, sheep, etc. And that it has to be hot. If it's cold with cold, for instance, you take gvina tzuba, mozzarella slice, or Munster cheese, and kol kat, both of them cold, you put it in a sandwich and you eat. Is this a sin from the Torah or from the rabbis? Huh? From the rabbis. Why? Because it wasn't cooked. It's cold. If one of them is hot, touching the cold, it's cooking the cold as well, together. That's already become from the Torah. Or both of them, needless to say, both of them are hot. Or you put them, both of them in the oven and they cook together. Or you put dripping milk inside meatball pasta, or things like this. That's already a strict sin from the Torah. But here we are now talking not about eating. Mitzvah number 92 doesn't speak about the restriction to eat it. It speaks about the restriction to cook it, which means a Jew cannot work in McDonald's. Kosher Jew, religious Jew, not allowed to work there. You might come and say, what? It's in Harlem. No Jews coming here, Rabbi. It's a neighborhood of all black people. I never saw one time a Jew, needless to say, a religious Jew, come to eat here a cheeseburger. And so what's the problem? I cook it for Mr. Williams and Mr. Jackson. What's the problem? So the answer is, the Torah told you as a Jew not to cook it even for your dog, needless to say, for people. For dog, you're not allowed to cook it. You want to cook it for people? Not allowed to cook it. Even if you want to make experiments. For no one. I'm practicing being a chef. Practicing. Oh, I want to teach people to be chefs. Don't touch it. Once I finish, I dump it in the bathroom. Not allowed to put it together even for experiments. Any kind of cooking, meat and dairy, it's a sin from the Torah, just like eating it. So that's mitzvah number 92. Mitzvah number 93, not to make a covenant, a peace agreement with the seven filthy, cursed nations that lived in Israel when the time the Jews arrived to the Holy Land. Aprizia, Emoria, Evusia, Girgashia, Knaani, these seven nations that are mentioned in the Torah were all idols worshippers. Remember, by the Goim, by the Gentiles, not every Gentile is equal spiritually to another Gentile from a different nation. Today, we don't know on anybody what is the source of where you came from. You look at Mr. Jackson and Mr. Smith, two Americans live in the same town, and one can be Knaani, and one can be Ishmaeli. So what? He looks white with American accent. How do you know that 1,000 years ago his grandmother wasn't Fatma from Saudi Arabia? How do you know? She moved to England, and from there her granddaughter moved to Australia. From there until they ended up here in New York. And he thinks he's American from the Aryan race. And in reality, he's completely Ishmaeli. Or you look at Mustafa from the deserts of Morocco, that they have no idea that this guy is from Amalek, and it's completely Amalek. Why, his grandparents are from Amalek, but then eventually they arrive to Morocco, and he born in Morocco, and his genes change, he looks darker, because the Zohar explains that where you live, it's affecting your genes to become wider or darker, it changed the eyes, the image. I show it in Torah and Science as one of the scientific proof that the Torah knew that the climates and the air that we breathe affect our genes. So now he looks completely Middle Eastern. He speaks with Middle Eastern accent, and in reality is Bechlal Amalek, like the Germans. You understand? Now, not all Germans is Amalek. We have no idea how. You know why we don't know? For a few reasons. One reason is that the nations immigrate one to another by themselves. But it used to be more than 2,000 years ago, a king, his name was Sancheriv, and he made such a revolution in the world. He started to chase nations from one place to the other, and the old world became a soup. All got mixed, Israeli salad. Everything got mixed. That's why you don't know about any Gentile what's his source. You can only know that the black people are from the descendants of Ham. Why? But again, not all black people. Because white people who joined the black people 2,000 years ago, 2,000 years later, their grandchildren from white became completely black or vice versa. So that's really, in reality, there's no guarantee about any Gentile what's his source. You don't know. That's why some of the obligations that we have with our relationship to certain Gentiles does not apply today. Because there's no way to know what's his source. There's no way to know. Also by the Jews, we don't know from which tribe we are. We don't know 100% that we're Jewish. We don't know. So the world today is not what it used to be. It's a different world. But what are we saying here? The seven nations, in the time when the Torah was given, it was very obvious. Everybody knew this is Kna'ani and this is not. So these seven nations, other nations, mitzvah to do peace with them. Why to fight? These idols, worshippers, that I cannot stand them, you are the chosen people, my children. I don't give you permission to make peace with them. Don't make. Hashem, I'm not in a mood for wars. Leave me alone. I want to make peace with this Kna'ani or Emori. I'm not interested in wars. Let's make peace. I give him his side. I take my side. Finished. Hashem said, no, you don't have permission. Making peace with him is declaring war against me. What is it like? Your father has a big enemy that he cannot stand. And you decided to be friends with your father's enemy. And your father comes to you and says, don't make peace with him. So the son says, Abba, it's my nature. I want to be in peace with everyone. He says, with everyone, yes. With him, no. You understand? And you still go and make peace with him. Obviously, it ruins your relationship with your own father. Needless to say, your spiritual father. Why Hashem cannot stand them? Because they're born with big noses? Or their eyes is green? Why Hashem doesn't like them? He make all people. Why would I hate something I make? Because of their sins. Because of their sins. Their sins were way too big to bear. This kind of sins. And sometimes it's called in Hebrew, Lakdish et ha-se'ah. You get to a level already, there's no return from there. If the nation of Israel would stay another month in Egypt, we would never come out of there, Chazal say. Because we were already in 49 gates of impurity. One more month or a week, we would go into the 50th gate. There's no return from there. Once you're there, you're finished. The mitzvah number 94, within 94 and 95, is short and we finish for today. Mitzvah number 94, not to allow idol worshippers to sit in the Holy Land. You understand? They want to be resident. In Israel, somebody from these seven nations comes to you. Today is the Chinese, some of the Indians. They want to come and they want to make a temple in Tel Aviv for Buddha and all his friends. Not allowed to let them. Not like the foolish Israeli government give them funds. Welcome, welcome. We like it. Cultural Tel Aviv. Come, what do you want? You want maybe we subsidize the building? Maybe we pay half of your electric bill. Why? They don't care about Hashem. They make all the sins. You think they care about this or this? They do everything, sometimes on purpose, to get the religious people angry. But the Torah didn't give permission. Why Hashem doesn't want idols worshippers to even live a week in Israel at all? Why? Because they will influence my children to become filthy like them. And I don't want this kind of influence. You understand? So, okay, now, so this is, that's called someone who wants to be a resident. No male and no female are allowed to let them in. If you're allowed to let them in, for instance, if they want to rent a place for you to make a church, if you own a building or an apartment in Israel, and he comes to you and says, I want to rent it, I want to make a church here, and I'll pay you 10 times more, you're not allowed. I'll pay you $100 million. Give me this building. I want to make a church here. What do you care? It's Tel Aviv. Anyway, there's no religious Jews here. You're not allowed. If you rent it to him, you become a partner to all his idols worshiping that they worship JC over there. Every sin they make, every time they worship their fake Messiah, you become a part of it. That's what's happened. And every Jew will get influenced by their nonsense of all these missionaries. You're going to pay the price for each one of them. Why? Your greed made you destroy your eternity. And the last mitzvah for today, mitzvah number 95, V'ikhu li truma. It's mitzvah to build a house for Hashem. It's come from Parashat Truma. What's special about building a house for Hashem? Today we don't have a temple, so we build synagogue. Synagogue is like, symbolize the temple, but it's really not the temple. But Hashem wanted us to make a special place for sacrificing those pure animals that he mentioned in the Torah. The animals, the sacrifices are with lots of deep secrets in it. It's all reincarnation of wicked people. It's not a coincidence why this sheep arrived to the altar and his friend didn't. His friend was slaughtered to become a barbecue in someone's backyard, and that sheep went to Beit HaMikdash, to the big altar, and they slaughter it and all these things that they do with that. It's all people. It looks like animals, but it's people like us who were big sinners and they got reincarnated in animals. Now, in which animal you get reincarnated is also supervised. For instance, someone who has the merit to have a tikkun fall into a sheep or a cow. Because once he gets slaughtered and it gets butchered on the altar and burned, that's erasing his sins from previous life. Someone who still his time did not arrive to get rid of his sins, he can get reincarnated in a filthy animal like a dog, a crow, a snake, etc. Depend on the sins. You understand? So if you want to know which wicked person is getting reincarnated in which animal, take the book of the Ari HaKadosh, the greatest Kabbalist in the last 2,000 years, and it's called Shaar HaGilgulim, the Gate of Reincarnations. And he explains which sin will send you in which body of what animal. Now, in case you thought, what's so bad of being a little puppy dog in a $20 million mansion on the beach of Rai here? He has great life. Better than 99% of the people who sit 3 hours in traffic to make $40,000 a year and walk all day without a dollar in their pocket. And all the other worry and problem and tuition and colleges and their children and drugs and divorce and this. Ooh, look at this puppy jumping by the pool, going in this, eating great things. So, you know, well, great life he has. So what's the problem being reincarnated? All you have to hope that you're going to be the dog of Michael Jackson and everything will be fine. But this comes out of ignorance. We are not talking about a dog that gets kicked on the street. Get out of here, you know, annoying dog, and he's freezing in the street, and this is the punishment. No. The soul doesn't care about the physical situation of the dog, whether he's in a warm house or whether he's on the street freezing. The soul doesn't feel this. The soul means that you're taking the most holy and the highest spiritual divine thing in this world, which is the soul of a person, and glue it to the nefesh of the filthiest animal, which is the dog. And that's a horrible spiritual suffering and pain to a person who used to be a person and he became this filthy dog. And remember, it has nothing to do with physical. Same thing, mikveh has nothing to do with the clean body or not. You came out of shower, he's still impure. You can be very dirty. You go into a mikveh full of sand and mud and dirty water that was never replaced for 5 years, and you went in and out, and you're pure. And then you take a shower from the dirt. But to purify has nothing to do with body. Same thing here. The reincarnation is not that the soul feels, wow, what a horrible freezing day, and I have nowhere to sleep, and I'm hungry, I have to look in the garbage, and the garbage today is empty. No. It's putting a soul together, glued together to the blood of this dog is the nefesh. Right now we have a nefesh of a person. Nefesh of the person and the ruach is the intelligence and the soul is the neshama. It's all one unit. There's two other pieces, chaya and yechida. 5 pieces is the soul. But now we're taking the nefesh of the man. Once he dies, goes to the grave and that's it. The worms eat it. It's finished. And instead, they take the soul and put it in the nefesh of a dog. Oh, 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 what a suffering. I don't want to tell you. Who comes in reincarnation of dogs? What they call today gays. They come in this reincarnation. Read by the Ari. Let them make parades as much as they want. people get very angry from the religious people. And I say, if they only knew where these people would be in 10 years from now, you wouldn't be angry at them so much, because you know they're going to get paid so much for their sins. But believe me, all the smiles and dancing that they have on the streets will turn into very bitter tears of many, many years. In Hebrew, we say, Amevin Yavin. If you're brave to see, go inside and read what's going to be their end. Why? The creator of the world make male and female, and you want to change? You want to challenge him? You want to change the law of nature? Chatsuf. This is the biggest chutzpah. Just because you have a filthy mental sickness and desire to do something against God, now you're going to twist the entire law of nature for your crooked, filthy mind? For that, you're going to change now the whole world? No, it's natural. It's good. Why not? Let's get married. The next thing, they're going to want to marry dogs. What's the problem? I want to marry him. But it's against nature. People are with people. No. Why? You tell me who to marry? I'm in love with my dog. Give him a marriage certificate. Bring two witnesses to marry them. If you're laughing, it's already happened a few times in the world. People marry their animals in a real ceremony. Check in the internet. Better not to check. There's even a foolish Jew who made bar mitzvah to his dog and got tefillin for him. Baruch Hashem, not for me. But he got him tefillin. He probably got him a better tefillin than what most Jews buy from me. Don't you have cheaper, Rabbi? $700? It's too much. It's 1 year of work. 1 year. And it's expensive. I believe it's very, very cheap, the price you're getting it. No, but I heard somebody sell it for $500. What is it like? Somebody comes to you and say, I will sell you a car. You don't ask which car. How much? $20,000. Ooh, so expensive. You crook. You thief. So, it's a brand new Lexus. $20,000. It's $100. No, for you, $20. Before you know what you get, yeah, it may sound expensive. Same thing here. Just to say tefillin. You know how many different levels you have? Every change in a tefillin, it's extra hours of work, extra 4 hours, extra 2 days of work. It's not just they make up a price because it's a little bit darker, what? A little bit more paint? What do you think? Same thing, car. Why car have different prices? You have a very sophisticated computer in this car, and here there's nothing. It costs the company another $2,000-$3,000 to make it, to put it. That's why they put an extra $7,000 in the price of the car. This is all electronic, this is not, this is have airbag, this is doesn't have, this is have special wheels, this is not. Everything makes the car more expensive. Rabbi, but it's the same brand name. This is Honda and this is Honda. But this costs three times more. Because the extra costs more than the body of the car. What do you think? Same thing, mezuzot. You have Arabs and prostitutes in Israel who writes mezuzot. And you buy them here for $35, $40 because you're cheap, stingy. You don't want to pay $65, $70 or $100, whatever they sell it for. Don't you have cheaper? And what do you have? Israeli students who work at night in prostitutions in hotel. They have good hand, artists. They learn art in the university. And they copy mezuzot, and sell it. And that's it. There's crooks like everything else. What do you think? In kosher food, there's no crooks? You know how many places you think you buy good kosher food and in the end it's dog meat or donkey meat? Everywhere. Didn't you hear the story about this Finkel Arasha that was selling 10 years non-kosher chickens? And he was deciding which kids will get accepted to one of the most important yeshivot in town. He was on a board. Why don't you want to pay full tuition, you crook? Why you drive this car and you tell us you don't have money? No, take your son to a different yeshiva. While an hour earlier, he was feeding the most important rabbis with taref meat. And an hour later, he was sitting on a board, and tomorrow he's going to blow the shofar in Rosh Hashanah. There's nothing to be surprised at this world. Remember, don't be naive. Don't judge people by the size of their beard or how big is their sombrero. So we're done. We did, Baruch Hashem, 15 mitzvot today. We're going to do the lecture here. I know it's hard with the parking. Maybe Emmanuel has a solution. I don't know. Or maybe we just have to come 10, 15 minutes earlier to find parking, or maybe you do carpool. For me, it's good because my next lecture is 3 blocks away from here. So I don't have to drive all the way. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rabbi Bloom. Thank you very much. Okay.